Great. Just wanted to remind you of a couple of examples from last time. We won't have time to go through all of the definitions again, but at least the examples I want to refer to repeatedly. Also, I changed one of them very slightly. So the first example are the k-colorings. So maybe I don't write this on the board, but just so we all remember, my setting now is I have some letters, I have ZD, and I'm going to make just some rules on which pairs of letters can sit next to each other. Hopefully that sounds kind of familiar from the last talk. So k-colorings just means that you have k letters in your alphabet. You can think of them as colors. And the only thing you forbid is an adjacent pair which is equal. So for instance, 2-2 is no good. You can't have 2-2 next to each other. For 2, this is the hard square model that I defined last time, but I made a very tiny change to it. I'm going to allow the possibility that you have a lot of copies of the zero symbol. So maybe I have zero symbols like 0 sub 1, 0 sub 2, up through 0 sub m, but still, the only restriction in the entire shift is that you can't put ones next to each other. So I see at least a couple of people scowling at me, so this may be a little bit confusing. So just to be clear, the idea is that you've got something from the normal hard square shift. Remember, the only rule was that you don't have two ones next to each other. And then literally you can assign the subscripts to these as you like, because there's no restriction among the subscripts whatsoever. So maybe I say 0, 1, 0, 2, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, et cetera, et cetera. The number of scowls has decreased by at least one, so I will assume this is okay. Any questions about the examples? Yeah. You were the scowl, by the way, yeah. So good, I'm glad.
There would be a possibility also to put a potential on your configuration. This would be a way of avoiding the reaching method, right?
Yes, so we're jumping 5 minutes before the first reference I was going to make to potential, but that's okay. The idea is everything I'm talking about today is for entropy. A lot of people in the audience are experts enough to know that everything I'm about to say, I could also say for topological pressure. And I could also do it by adding some kind of potential or energy to interactions between symbols. I don't have a good reason for not doing that besides the talks are hard enough as it is. But that's fine. So the trick here, as you said, I'm secretly putting an activity of M on the zero symbol. But you'll note I can do it without ever saying activity potential, which is the only hope that we will all get through this together. Does that answer the question? Is that okay? Cool. I'll try to say at least a tiny bit more about potentials at the relevant time. All right, so let me remind you what on earth we're talking about. So we're talking about measures of maximal entropy. I will write this at most one time per day, because from now on they're MMEs, as you might remember. And this is for ZD-SFTs, where D is greater than 1. I think I won't review everything I said last time on the board, but out loud, if you have D equals 1, they're Markov chains, and they had some kind of a wonderful uniformity property. If you don't remember what the uniformity property was, that's fine, because it will be a consequence of what I write on the board right now anyway. Okay. One small note, D is greater than 1. I am writing on a blackboard, so really D is going to be 2 for everything I tell you about today in terms of pictures, examples, etc. So maybe I should say my examples or pictures will be for D equals 2, but everything I say will hold for larger D. Okay. All right, so let's go ahead and make a definition. A measure on A to the ZD, but again, for today, it will really be A to the Z2, is called a uniform Markov random field or a uniform MRF if, okay, let's all relax and take a deep breath. Because this definition will take at least 10 minutes. It's a little funny, but once we understand the definition, we'll kind of get a sense for how to work with everything for the rest of the talk. So what's the property I want? What I want to say is, suppose I have some set S, okay? And suppose that I have a word or a pattern on S. Okay? Suppose that in addition, I put some letters on the boundary of S. So this is boundary of S, and we have a pattern, let's call it V. By the way, more than any other time of the talk, stop me and bother me if what I end up doing doesn't make sense. I am happy to spend 20 minutes on this definition if it helps. All right, so what do I want to say? And then I'm going to say one other thing. Let's say that out here, I have a different shape T, and I have some pattern U, which is a pattern on T. Okay, first of all, I haven't told you what the boundary of S is, so I should tell you this. The boundary of S, because we're in ZD, right? If these were topological things in like RD, maybe it would make sense. But in ZD, I should say, the boundary of S is just the set of all sites in S complement, which are adjacent to a site in S. Okay? Because I want to do an explicit example in a moment anyway, let's draw a discretized version of this picture over here that we can refer to. So maybe my set S will look like this. And what would be great is if we have colors of chalk. So here's one. So if this is my set S, S is in white. Everybody agrees that the boundary, the way I defined it, should be in pink then, right? It's all of the things not in S which are next to something in S. And again, just in case I haven't been explicit, next to really just means horizontal vertical. I mean differing by a basis factor. So the pink will be pink. And I don't suppose I'm lucky enough to have another color of chalk. Ah, great. Let's say blue will be some other crazy set that is just disjoint from these and has no significance whatsoever yet. So, I don't know, maybe it's out here. You'll see why blue, or sorry, you'll see why T is not so important in a minute. Okay, picture's all right. Good. So now what I want to say is, first of all, let's say that W, U, T, maybe I should put those in order, or no, U, V, W, is legal in X. If you really want me to write a formal definition for what UVW is, I will do it, but I just mean the thing you get by putting UV and W together. So in other words, once I consider the pattern on the white, the pattern on the pink, the pattern on the blue together, still there are no problems with adjacencies or anything like that. Okay, looks like we're still okay. What on earth does this have to do with a measure? It's about conditional probabilities. So now we finally say, yeah, good. So as I said in the first talk, I'm being very lazy and I'm only going to consider systems where they're the same. However, every time I say legal, if you want to know sort of in the real world what it means, it's always globally admissible. So let's say globally admissible in X. As I said, I think for all the examples we're talking about, this subtlety should not appear, but very good question to clarify. Before we say the measure, any question? All right, good. Here's all that the definition means. It's not that bad. What a uniform MRF means is if you take mu of seeing W, hopefully you remember this little bracket notation around W just means the set of all points which contain a W at this location, and I condition on the probability of seeing V. Okay? So what I'm saying is, once you know some configuration on the pink letters, what's the probability of seeing a particular configuration on the white letters? Well, I want to say actually two things secretly together. So the first is, seeing the stuff on the blue letters outside, which you might remember was U, has absolutely no effect on this conditional probability. So in other words, if I want to know the chance of seeing some certain pattern on the white letters, and I tell you what's going on the pink letters, adding information about the blue letters has absolutely no effect whatsoever. Okay? Again, I promise examples are coming if this is a little funny. Just for probabilists, I'll say, really what I should have said is that T is just the entire ZD outside these shapes, the complement. But But then I have to worry about the conditional information function because the event won't have positive probability. So let's define it like this to make it easy. Fine. Even better news. I can also tell you exactly what this probability is. It's equal to 1 divided by the number of W on S, which are legal. Again, this means globally admissible. When combined with V. Okay? If you don't like that, I could phrase this another way. I could say it's actually equal to W prime given V for any other W prime, where W prime V is legal. Okay. Sorry, it's a bad definition. I didn't make it, so I don't have any choice. So again, informally, let's go through one more time what this says, and then let's go straight to an example, and I think that will help everything. So what it says is, suppose I want to know the probability of seeing something on the white letters given the pink letters. Very simple. All the choices for the white letters have to get the same conditional probability. Therefore, it's a probability measure, so I just count how many I could put here, and 1 divided by that is the common conditional probability for every one. And in addition to this, if I decide I want to put some blue letters outside, it affects nothing. How are we doing? Okay. Informally, this blue letter thing should make sense, because remember, what are the only restrictions for my SFTs for now? They're between adjacent pairs of letters. Anybody see the relevant pair of colors which cannot contain adjacent pairs of letters here? Oh yeah, yeah, sorry, I should have put quantifiers here. So it's all U, V, and W, and S. I mean, S is also arbitrary. All right, where do I need to put all of the quantifiers? Found one. I think this is good. So it's really any time you draw this picture whatsoever. What's that?
T also.
And for all, where's the T? Ha! And I don't have to say for all boundary of S, because boundary of S is uniquely determined by S. Okay. So going back to what I was saying a minute ago, I hope this makes sense because the blue and white can't be next to each other. That's the definition of the boundary. So in some sense, if I want to know what I can put in here without causing a problem, it only depends on the pink letters. It's not a proof of why this property holds, but maybe it should be believable. You had a question, Benjamin?
Are you saying that this uniform Markov random field exists for all SFTs?
So far, all I have said is that this is a thing that I define. Maybe I wasted 20 minutes and there aren't any.
It's not a measure when you define the explicit probability.
So, I don't know, maybe I'm saying this badly. I can define, you know, I don't know, I was going to say something.
If you fix mu of every cylinder, yeah. You have to check that it's coherent, like you have to something to check, but if it's...
So I think a theorem's coming that will answer your question. All I can say for now, this object may not exist. I mean, that's not true, it does exist, but as of the information you have had conveyed from me, I've said nothing about existence. I've just said, let's call a measure this if by some chance it has all of these mystical, wonderful properties, and there are some. Great, really good questions. Any other question here? Okay, this was too hard, so this is hard until we do an example, so but before the example, let's state the theorem, yeah. So this is board one. That is board 3. Any other questions while the boards are moving? These 10 seconds just kill me where I'm moving the boards and I'm not doing any math. It's
I have another question actually.
Good, yeah.
Are you saying the second line when you define the actual probability, is it a consequence of the first one somehow?
It is, okay, so now I actually almost can reach. So it's actually a consequence of the first being equal to the third. Because if I say W and W prime have the same conditional probability, regardless of the W and W prime, and they sum to 1, then they have to be 1 over.
You could get it's a uniform adjective.
Uniform.
I mean, you could get non-uniform random fields.
Not today, but one may be able to do so. Yeah?
What's the status of X? You have X legal in X, but there's no X in the beginning of the definition.
That is a really good question. Yeah, sorry.
Is X given?
X should be given, yeah. While I was writing, I was thinking I can define this generally, but you're right, for this I need X. So let's say, okay, good. Yeah, thank you. If you want the truth is the Markov random field property is just this part. That part can be defined without access to X. The uniform part that I'm kind of mushing together with this is this part. And of course, as you say, for this you need the definition of X. Thank you very much for catching that. Anything else before I move the board out of my reach? All right. No, see, and now I'm lost again. All right, one. Cool. This is board three. All right. So why do I care about these things at all? As Benjamin said, I still haven't told you they exist. So what's the theorem? Theorem. Let me quote this as Lanford-Ruel, and I promise I'll address that Lanford-Ruel is really more general before any experts tell me that this isn't quite the right statement. Well, the theorem is very simple. Any MME on a nearest neighbor SFTX is a uniform Markov random field, right? So if you believe in the variational principle, this is my proof that uniform Markov random fields exist, because for subshifts, you always have at least one measure of maximal entropy, okay? So the way I'd like you to think about this is that given an MME, all conditional probabilities of the form mu of W given V for W with shape S and V with shape boundary of S are completely determined. I mostly wrote all of this so that I can upset you even more when I say that doesn't uniquely determine the measure somehow. I mean, if you're an expert, again, maybe this isn't surprising, but it's kind of surprising at first. It feels like if I tell you every single conditional probability of this sort, I must be uniquely determining U, or mu, sorry, but as I'll tell you in a minute, that's not the case. All right, why did I say Lanford-Ruel here is more general? This goes back to your question earlier. Really, Lanford-Ruel is about some world where you don't just take entropy, you take something called topological or measure-theoretic pressure. And what this involves is that instead of saying just whether an adjacency is legal or not, you actually sort of give it a score or an energy or something like this, and you say that some legal adjacencies you like more than others. I think that sounds really hard, so let's not do that today, but the true Lanford-Ruel has more strength. Okay, cool. Now let's do an example. So let's look at an eraser. Okay. So let's redraw this. And let's compute a conditional probability. Let's take the traditional hard square shift, not the one with many, many letters, just the normal hard square. And suppose I have mu, which is an MME on it. At the moment, this is a mysterious object that I don't know much about, but I know conditional probabilities at the very, very least. So for instance, let's talk about the conditional probability. Maybe over here I'll say, and then I need the pink again. Okay, so let's talk about mu of I hope the notation here is clear, but tell me if you don't like it. The idea is somehow I don't want to have to draw the origin every time, so can we extrapolate from this picture to see where the sets in question sit over here? Some people are nodding and some people are emphatically not nodding. So all I'm saying is the probability of seeing the white letters once you say that you see the pink letters. All right? Well, if you believe the theorem, this should just be equal to 1 divided by the total number of ways that I can fill in from the pink letters. Okay, so let me erase the white letters. Sort of making a joke, but I want to say, I'm sorry if you were writing down the right letters, but the point is, you shouldn't have cared that much because they didn't matter. So even if I cut you off in the middle, I'm not that sorry, let's say. How many ways can you fill this? Anyone want to show off and tell me really fast? Oh, so a couple people said powers of 2 plus 1, which is right. I think 17 is the right answer here, because what are the choices? Well, if I put a 1 there, now, there's not too much I can do. Everything around it is a zero. That's one, I'll keep count. If I put a zero there, I have 4 places that I can put in twos. So I don't have 16 more fingers, but pretend I'm holding toes up. So you get 17 different amounts here, okay? Fine, so we end up getting 1 over 17 here. Questions, comments about this? Okay? Let me use the same example to illustrate one other point that's going to be really important later. You don't need to have an entire configuration here. In other words, let's leave what I wrote here, just that zero. Suppose I want to know just the probability of having a zero at the center. Well, the first thing you could say is, oh my god, that doesn't fall exactly under the auspices of the theorem you defined, let's give up. But don't do that. Because what you can say is, do anybody remember how many of these configurations had a zero in the center? 16 of them. So it's 16 17ths. So what I want to do is to say, maybe let's just put this board back down for 1 second. This, in fact, gives you mu of w given v, even when w is on some shape S prime, where S prime is a strict subset of S. And I mean, if you don't believe that, that's literally what we just did. So if you want a conditional probability of something that just lives inside S, it's fine. You just take the number of things that see the smaller pattern divided by the total number of ways of filling. You're doing a convincing job of making me think this is okay. So unless there are specific questions, I'll go on. Are we good? All right. So let me raise that back up. All right. So, good. No one's asked me the obvious question yet. So the obvious question is, what about the converse? Right? So I said any uniform or any MME is a uniform MRF. What about the converse? Okay. Well, the converse is false. The converse is false for some really, really silly reasons. One of the silly reasons is, nowhere here did I give you any shift invariance properties of this measure whatsoever. It's very static. So problem one is, so I'll say, of course not. Uniform MRF, not necessarily shift invariant. Okay? Okay, so fine, let's be mathematicians. What if I remove that obstruction? What if I assume it's shift invariant? Then it actually is true under some more assumptions. So let me give another theorem. So, okay, probably the shortest way is to give you an example. And I'll want this example later anyway. Let's take X to be two colorings on Z2. I'll give everyone a moment to think about the fact that I just defined an incredibly stupid system. One and two are the colors, and they can't sit next to each other. So what is this? This is actually a system consisting of 2 points. And it's shift. So even though it sounds silly, the delta measure that lives there is absolutely a uniform MRF. Why? Because if I take any shape and cut it out, the number of ways to fill it is 1, because I can't have 1 and 2 sitting next to each other. And so I could literally take the delta measure, and that would be a uniform MRF. I know that example was a little fast, so let me try the other answer I thought of. Nowhere here did I say that these were the same when I move S, T, and sigma, and boundary of S. So I mean, when I move those things over, these things are still true, but it definitely might not give me the same measure. That's a really important question, though, so I'm glad it got asked. I still hear people talking to each other, which is okay, but do you have any questions I can help with? I probably know. All right, fine. So let me state a theorem here of Dobruschen. If your X is strongly irreducible. And here I really want to be careful because this is not doing a good job for Dobruschen. In fact, you need less. But for the purposes of the definitions I can give in 3 lectures, let's just say strongly irreducible. Then the converse is true. Then a sigma invariant uniform MRF is in fact an MME. Okay? Very briefly, before we do anything else, let me try to do 2 things at once. First of all, I know the last time you saw SI was yesterday, so let's remind of what this actually is. SI just said that if you give me 2 shapes, maybe let's make the other shape something really weird like an annulus. Anybody remember what SI is and want to remind the group? No one likes questions. So it tells you that if I give you any two shapes, you can fill in between them. And for SI, what do we have to say about the distance?
It's constant.
It's constant. Cool. Thanks for reminding us. So here, SI says you can fill in between two legal patterns with a constant distance. If that doesn't sound familiar, I have to prove something's SI for you later. So if you're panicked and like, oh God, I don't know what it is, we'll have to actually prove this and we'll get a good sense. I just wanted to remind you so that I can at least do some due diligence with Dobrishin. When I say in fact less here, for this theorem you could get away with little o of n. You could say if you have two shapes with diameter n and you want to fill in between them, the mixing distance, I think Benjamin defined it as topological mixing with some distance, could be little o of n, and this theorem would still be true. Okay? It's really hard to make examples where it's not constant and it's little o of n, so with your permission, I'm going to use this weaker version here. Cool. So now we have some sort of a diagram. Let me draw that, and then we'll do something else. So the diagram I want to draw is MME implies sigma invariant uniform MRF. That's always for the definitions that I've given you today. The reverse direction, for the purposes of our definitions, requires SI. Okay, fine. There's actually a third thing I want to add to this diagram here, but for that I need to make a definition. Let's do that over here. So see, it's too quiet. I can't stand it. I'm just going to talk, just to hear myself talk. Any questions while we're doing this? No? Okay. Okay. So the next, while we're waiting, since this is easy, the next definition we're going to make is nothing exciting. I just keep talking about this business where you take a configuration on the boundary and you take the uniform measure on the interior. Like, remember the pink letters up here, and we said all of the ways of filling this were equally likely. It'll be nice to have notation for this. So this is very boring. It's something we've already seen. But I'll just say if, what did I call it before? V, actually let's call it delta for now, is a configuration on some boundary of S. Let's call the uniform measure on S, well, let's rephrase this. Let's call the measure on A to the S, which is uniform over all ways to fill S given V, or given delta. Let's call this U of delta, okay? Sorry, this is my least favorite part of a math talk. I just wrote a bunch of stuff to literally say things we already said. I just want this notation to be easy. So all this is you give me something like the pink letters there. It induces a measure on the inside of the pink letters, which is literally just take all of the ways you could possibly fill in legally, give each one measure one divided by that. Just to see if this makes sense, uniform MRF, if mu is a uniform MRF, then what does this mean? This means that if you take mu mu conditioned on delta and then marginalize to S, this should be equal to U of delta. Again, I apologize. I hate this part of a talk because I've said nothing that I haven't said before. I just made letters for things we've already said. So all I'm saying is this is the measure where you put down some letters and you fill in equally. Okay. Why did I bother with any of this? Because sometimes this is a useful way to try to construct these things. So the third thing I want to put on my diagram is a limit of U of some sequence delta sub n as delta sub n recedes off to infinity. So really this is true more generally, but what I want you to picture are just some boundaries on boxes where the boundaries on the boxes are floating off to infinity here. Okay? All right. Well, there is an implication arrow here, but let's go slowly because I'm worried the notation is bogging us down. If I start with some boundaries, each one I fill in uniformly, and then I take a, perhaps I should have said a weak limit, as they go to infinity. I hope you believe me that the resulting object definitely is a uniform MRF. Okay? I'm going to do something really silly and just say here, if it's shift invariant, then it's a shift invariant uniform MRF. Not a very exciting arrow there. But so all I'm saying is, take a limit of these things as you go off to infinity. This uniformity property will be preserved. And if I assume sigma invariant, then I can get to here. Okay? Only one more implication arrow I want to draw. Sorry, I have to add a couple of words. Weak limit of a weighted average of these things. That changes nothing. The last implication arrow I want to draw is this one, and I want to say that that holds all the time. Okay? And let's actually prove that together, because I think, again, if this is the first time you've seen it, we still want to build some facility with these things. So what's the statement I just told you? I just said if mu is a uniform MRF, then in fact, it's a weak limit of some average of some u of delta n's, okay? Let's go ahead and see why this is true together, and the proof, unfortunately, will not be very illuminating. The proof is getting used to the type of manipulation of symbols that we need to do to work with these things. So suppose I start with a u that's a uniform MRF, okay? Fine. Let's look at mu restricted to some set. And in fact, I don't see any reason to be vague here. Let's look at mu restricted or marginalized to an n cube. Okay? So I want to know what's going on with mu on this shape here. All right, I'm worried. We don't look happy. Stop me if I can help. Fine. Well, I want to make a very boring statement. There are many possible configurations that I could put on the boundary there. Let's do easy statements. Do we agree with the statement, I can put things on the boundary? Good, you have to agree with that. Do we agree with the statement, each one of the things I can put on the boundary has some measure? Okay? But then I think we're in good shape, because what I can say is I can write this as a weighted average over the possible deltas that I can put here, and now I'm just going to use some extremely boring conditional probability formula. This is equal to a sum. Okay. And then restricted, oh no, let's write this a little bit. Okay. I can tell some people aren't happy with this. I promise it should make sense if we study later. So all I'm saying is, I can definitely write this by just using this boring formula. For each delta, take its measure and then take the product of the conditional measure that I see after conditioning on delta and restricting. Fine, but if I'm a uniform MRF, and I marginal and I condition on some delta, and then I marginalize to the stuff inside delta, what does that have to be equal to just by the definition of a uniform MRF? It's this U thing I just defined. And now what is that? Well, that is a weighted average of U of deltas over some various deltas. I haven't taken a weak limit yet, but that's because this only gives me mu restricted or marginalized to minus n n to the d. If I let n go to infinity, this approaches mu. Okay, sorry, it's unavoidable that this is technical, but this bad part is over now. So all I did there is basically proved this other implication arrow here. All right, so now I want to talk about why on earth this diagram is useful, because we've gotten really bogged down into the weeds, and at some point I need to tell you what we actually want to try to do. So, let me write something here. Yeah?
If you would like to prove that the weak limit of averages of u delta n is uniform Markov.
Yes.
Do you need also do the average overall also the configuration of the fixed
I lost the question. Sorry, can you ask? So I understood the first part. If you want to prove that this limit is, or that this, yeah.
There is, we have a sequence of configurations.
Okay. Okay. But then you don't get anything inside here. Ah, okay, that's a good point. When I say delta n goes to infinity, let's actually define this. Let's say that this means the interiors or the associated S's that yielded them have union ZD. I'm not sure. Okay. Darn. Box or something? Yeah?
Box.
Yes.
And there it's not needed, yeah?
Okay. So you mean for this implication, we could even include the case where you average over different delta sub n's?
Yes.
Yeah, that's easy. I think the proof is basically that, yeah, we don't want to say much about the proof. The proof is it's true for single sequences, and then this class is closed under weighted averages anyway, so everything. Sorry it took me a minute to get your question. Okay. I'm worried we're all sad, so let's do some example things. So why on earth would I care about any of this? It turns out that uniqueness of MME is useful for many, many things. And just to try to tie this to some things we said yesterday, one example, which I don't claim to be exhaustive, is efficient computability, or let's say computation of the entropy, parentheses, day three. Even if I made you sad with technical things today, if you want to learn about this, you have to show up on day three. Okay, so I want to know how to see if your MME is unique. And that was really the reason for all of this painful setup over here. We want to analyze the question of when you have a single MME and when you have multiple ones. And unfortunately, the only way that I'm aware of for anyone to analyze this is through this question about weak limits of these averages of U of delta n. So let's transition to some examples so we can actually see how this is used in the real world, quote unquote. So what can we erase? Let's not lose that. Let's erase Linford Roel. So this was 4 and 3. Sorry for asking any time. Obviously, if there are questions, this is a great time to ask, so let me know. No questions, all right. So with the remainder of the time, and I guess this is a good time to ask, am I ending at 30 after or 25 after for the next talk? Oh, I don't know who's in charge. Okay, when I'm supposed to leave, make me stop. I will plan to try to end by a little before 30 after. All right. So now what I want to look at are some examples. Okay, probably without proof, I think, given the time that we have left, but that's okay. The main thing, first what I want to show you is, okay, I wasted 35 minutes of your life, 40 minutes of your life, setting up a huge mechanism to see if we can prove if MMEs are unique. I'd better convince you that they don't have to be unique, otherwise I wasted a lot of your time. So example one is, really, it's possible to have multiple MMEs, even if your ZDSFT, has really, really good mixing properties. In other words, you might remember that in one dimension, all you need are some basic mixing properties to avoid this. Since I've only defined one sort of good mixing property for you in Z2, I'll say SI. And this was a really big surprise when this happened. And what this example is it's called the iceberg model. And it was originally due to Burton and Stipe. And I think the best thing, since we just had to do a lot of technical things, let's just define a single SFT. Let me try to give you a vague sense of why you shouldn't be surprised that it has multiple MMEs, and we won't prove things about it. All right, so what do I need to do to describe an SFT for you? I need to give you an alphabet. The alphabet here is a bunch of minus symbols and a bunch of plus symbols. Note the glaring absence of zero. So there's no zero here. It's just negative m through negative one, and then positive one through positive m. I know it's not conventionally the case, but I want to put pluses next to all of the positive integers because we're going to distinguish between letters being negative or positive in this shift quite a lot. What are the rules? Well, okay, first let me say it the way I think they did it in the paper. We forbid an adjacent pair, ij, when ij is less than negative one. Okay. I wrote this because it's technically correct, but I hate it because then everybody's thinking, okay, so if I'm all... So let's just write it in an easier way. Can a plus sit next to a minus? Yes, but only if their product is minus one, meaning only if it's a plus one and a minus one. So the way I'd prefer you to think about this is a plus next to a minus is not okay or not allowed unless it's specifically a plus one next to a minus one, which is perfectly okay. All right, so this is how the system works. Pluses next to pluses, no restrictions. Minuses next to minuses, no restrictions. But a plus next to a minus means they're both plus or minus one. Okay? Probably a picture is the easiest way to understand this, so let me draw the picture not discreetly. The picture is just you have some islands of pluses and minuses. Okay, can't draw that, let's say. And what has to happen on sort of the boundary between an island of pluses and minuses, you have to see plus ones and minus ones. So let's say, for instance, here on this interface, these are plus and minus one, okay? I think I'll leave it at this because somehow the ZD discrete picture doesn't look much better. So that's what's happening here. Here's the claim, I mean, and it's a theorem of Burton and Stipe. Actually, I'll say theorems. Let's give this a name. Let's say that this iceberg model is I sub m, right? I for iceberg, m for the number of pluses and minuses that I put down here, which is a parameter. It could be anything. Theorems, I sub m is always si. We'll prove that together because it's easy and pretty fun. Theorem two that I don't think we'll prove together is if m is very large, I sub m has two, okay, ergodic MMEs. Okay? So this is the type of bad system that I've been warning you about the entire time. It has essentially the best topological mixing properties known to man. This is the strongest thing anybody ever uses for proofs, is SI. And yet, that helps you not in the slightest for figuring out whether there's a unique MME. So what this illustrates is that we're going to need other techniques for trying to prove uniqueness of MME. Okay. Let me explain to you why this statement is true, and at least explain without proof why statement two is true as well. I think we can get rid of the other examples. All right. So for SI, let me sort of prove this by means of a very simple lemma that'll make us a little more comfortable with this system. The lemma is in any point of the iceberg model, you can change any letters by dividing by the absolute value and the new point is still in I sub m. Okay, that was a weird way to say this that I don't like. Essentially what I'm saying is, if you see a 5, you can make it a 1. If you see a -7, you can make it a -1. And this should never hurt anything, okay? So just the implementation is, maybe this is my pattern. This would have to be a positive 1. Something that looks like this. All I'm saying is I can point to any letter and say U. I'm going to ignore your sort of size and just keep the sign, just change you to a +1. Okay? This is the worst kind of proof to do 45 minutes in, because there's nothing I can say besides this is obvious given the definition. In other words, there's no way I created a forbidden pattern, because the only forbidden patterns are negatives and positives that are not +1. So if I make it +1, I couldn't have possibly created a problem. All right. So why is this lemma useful? Now suppose I want to explain to you why this is strongly irreducible. Okay? So the claim I want to make is, it's SI at distance 2. What do I mean by distance 2? I just mean you give me any shapes in the universe and some patterns on them, and you make sure that the distance between them is at least 2, and I'm going to tell you that there's a way to fill in so that I create a legal point of the shift. All right. Sorry, the room's hot. There's lots of yawning. All right. The proof is easy, I promise, this late in the talk. Since V is legal, that means I can put some letters around it on the boundary. Since W is legal, meaning globally admissible, that means I can put some letters around it on the boundary. But what do you think I'm going to do to every single one of those letters that I just placed?
+1.
Yeah, hint, I just proved a lemma. So I'm going to replace them all with +1, and I'll still get something legal. Is there any chance that I have a problem when I try to put these together now? Yeah, +1's perfectly fine. What if they don't touch? How should I fill in the rest of ZD?
+1.
Yeah, you're just my +1 guy. Just keep saying +1. Okay, so sorry that that's fast, but the idea is pretty simple. Put some things around, make sure they all have +1, and then it's easy to fill in. Fine. So in the last 10 minutes or so here, of course I won't prove it, but let me at least say how you get the multiple MMEs. And the way you get the multiple MMEs is by taking some sort of a weak limit of some averages. So if the moment when I wrote all this was terrible, now we'll actually use it for an example and maybe it won't be so bad. So let's use this board. And why are there multiple MMEs? Okay, so I have to be careful to ask, because here I don't actually want +1 as the answer. So what I want to do is I want to say there are two different choices I could make for boundary conditions, such that when they recede to infinity, they induce different uniform MRFs, which turn out to be different MMEs. What are the boundary conditions? Well, pluses and minuses. So let me make some very silly definition here. Sigma plus is just a configuration. I define this as pattern. Pattern on the boundary of an n cube of all. Okay, in theory, it works for any plus that I want to do, but just in case we get time for a proof in day 3, let's say +m. Let's say sort of the most positive boundary you can possibly make. I hope we all agree that that is a legal boundary. Does that actually show up in the space? Yeah, I think so. If I fill everything else with m's, I'm okay. Well, sigma minus, and I need a parameter here, +n. I take a boundary of -m's. Well, here are some facts that I won't prove right now and maybe think about tomorrow. If you take u of sigma +n, this actually approaches a weak limit, mu plus. Okay? I didn't prove this for you, by the way. If you don't like the fact that I said it approaches a weak limit, it definitely has a weak limit point, because the space of probability measures is compact. I just would rather tell you the strongest statement. But if you don't believe me, think of a limit point. Similarly, these approach a limit. And there are two big claims I want to make. One isn't so big, It's that both of these are sigma invariant. Okay? And here, in no way is this a proof, but let me just sort of say something that should be believable. The boundaries were all the same symbol. I didn't alternate symbols. I didn't sort of do anything periodic. I literally put down the same symbol over and over. Maybe that should make it believable that the image you get from these limits is sigma invariant. The really difficult statement is that they're not equal to each other. And so once you have this, if you believe the crazy diagram I had over there, let's follow some arrows. Each one of them, if I say they're sigma invariant, then of course they're sigma invariant. And if we said the system was SI, then they're MMEs. So what this means from the diagram is that this gives you two MMEs on the system, okay? So I'm very carefully not asking if we understand why this is true, because I didn't tell you at all. But the statement of at least what we do to make the measures, can I clarify this at all? No? Okay. So let's... What is the definition? So in the paper, it's something explicit. It's also horrible, so I didn't write it down. It's got some exponentials. Don't quote me, but I think for d equals 2, the bound they get is something like 700 and some or something like this. So it's really quite big, but it is explicitly stated and you have a formula for it. This is definitely true. Really good question. Let's decide what to do in the last 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay, let's erase this part. Okay, and I apologize for lying, but I do think I'm going to at least tell you a rough idea of the proof, but I won't do the actual thing. Okay, so why is this true? Okay, so let's at least break down what the relevant facts are, and then again, I'll gloss over some details. The key fact is that mu plus of having a minus symbol is less than 1/2. Okay. Why should you care about this? Well, if you believe me that this is, this is not proved. But if it were true, what does this tell you? It tells you that mu plus of plus is greater than 1/2. Could you repeat the question? Oh, I think you actually said it, having a minus symbol?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good guess.
So your configurations are all positive. Everything is positive. Yeah, what position is like zero?
Maybe that was the problem there. So cylinder set of having a minus at a particular location. And of course, you're right. I really should write disjoint union of the cylinder sets corresponding to the symbols minus m through minus 1. But I'm still worried I'm not answering. So I'm just saying, there's an event which consists of the event that you see a minus sign at say, the origin. But the cylinder set can... Oh, okay, when you say cylinder set, this always means that you have to do this. Yes, I agree. So once we add the cylinder set, I hope it's better. But without it, it was very unclear. Okay, what was I saying? Oh, yeah, so it's a probability measure, and these things exhaust the alphabet. So I hope we agree that this is true. Now let me make a statement that's really not substantiated, but I think we'll believe it. And the mysterious word I want to put on that arrow is symmetry. In other words, if you flip the sign of every single thing that you see in a point, you're still legal. All of the rules here are invariant under flipping pluses and minuses. So what this ends up telling you is that these two things are in fact equal to each other. Well, if you believe all of the arrows that I drew, then you're in trouble because this would provide a proof that mu plus is not equal to mu minus. So okay, we've reduced this to another mysterious unexplained statement, which I'll call star. Why on earth is star true? Well, in 3 minutes, let me give you a fake proof. I should leave that diagram. We don't need the lemma. Okay. I'm just going so long because I at least want to show you the seed of one of these beautiful ideas that I wanted to show you in the mini course, which is something called a perils argument. So the question is, let's now look at mu plus comma n of having a minus symbol at the origin. What does this mean? This means that I've got a box and I put plus m's everywhere on the boundary. And what's here? Some lonely minus symbol. That doesn't look that bad. Maybe it's not that unlikely. But there's something very funny that's going to happen. Suppose I take this minus symbol and I extend it to the maximal connected component of minus symbols. Okay? I promise no more questions for today except these two. If that's the maximal component of minus symbols, what happens if I go a little further?
Plus symbols.
Plus symbols. Better answer. Plus. Yeah, you were my plus one guy. What's going on? Plus or minus one, yeah. Any more observations? The things next to the plus one in here have to be
minus
one. Cool. Everybody okay with that? So now let me draw this boundary around this. Two more minutes, I promise. Let's give a name to this boundary. Let's suppose that boundary there is boundary of the shape S. Now I want to say something very boring. This is a union over all the possible choices I could have made for this component here. And if I start with the minus, I expand it out to something. So this is a union over all possible S of, let's say, mu plus n. Since time is low, I can't write a perfect definition, but let me just call this event E sub S. But it should be conditioned. Yeah, now mu plus n E sub S. Last thing I have to convince you of, this event is extremely unlikely. Why is it extremely unlikely? Because there are many, many, many more ways to fill in these plus ones. Does anybody, well, no, I promise no more questions. I'll tell you. What's something we could do to fill this in many more ways? Step one, flip the minus island, or the minus component. Just to make sure we're all paying attention, that did not increase the number of fillings at all. That's just a bijection. But now, I have a huge amount of flexibility to make many, many more symbols. Because what can I do? Every one of those plus ones is only next to pluses. And if you're only next to pluses, you can do many more things besides plus one. In fact, you can do anything here. Okay, I'll write two more things on the board and then we'll be done. That was a very, very short and bad proof that in fact, this measure is less than m to the negative size of this boundary. Why? Because I could take every single one of those and replace it by m different things and make a bunch of new configurations, thus inflating the size by at least m to the size of the cardinality of, or the boundary. Why should you care about that? Oh, sorry, step two here was replace plus one by anything from plus one to plus m arbitrarily. Write the last thing on the board and then we'll be done. This sum is less than or equal to. Well, now let's index by the length. Someone give me an extremely boring bound for how many paths there are of length n. It can be really bad. Well, how many ways can I move? Well, if I needed to be a path in ZD, then maybe I could move four different ways. So I take all the possible choices for this, and there are four to the n choices. Luckily for me, m to the negative n kills four to the n when m is very large. So what does this do? This is an exponential sum. If m is very, very, very large, then it's less than 1/2. Then we take a limit. Last thing, and then I put the chalk down. It's less than 1/2 minus epsilon. That way, when I take a limit, I still get this statement here. So I don't expect that to have been perfect, but the very last thing I should say, this is a wonderful, wonderful, beautiful argument called a perils argument. I guess I at least should write that name. And it's applicable to show non-uniqueness for a variety of systems. And even if you hated the proof, the idea is you have an interface. The interface caused you to make some inefficient choices. You could make many more choices, and then you get some bounds like this. Don't worry if the proof made no sense. All we want for next time is that there is this example that has multiple. And what we'll finally talk about next time is how to show that there's only one, and why on earth any of you should care about only having one of them. So, thanks.